Imagine you have a cat in a box, but the box is a trap. There's a mechanism that releases sleeping gas, if and only if an atom decays. Except atomic decay is a quantum phenomenon. If we close this box and make no observations of what happens inside, then the atom is in what we call a superposition of being decayed and not decayed. Does that mean the cat is also in a superposition of being both asleep and awake? No, don't be ridiculous. Hey, crazies. What we're talking about here is the infamous Schrodinger's cat experiment. And the original version is much more grim than the one I just described. Thankfully, it's just a thought experiment. No one has actually done this. It's infamous because trying to answer this question always starts arguments, which was exactly the entire point of this hypothetical. When Erwin Schrodinger came up with the idea in the 1930s, it was meant as a critique of quantum philosophy. It was never meant to be taken seriously. While quantum mechanics certainly works well on particles, we shouldn't assume that it also works on objects, animals, or people. At least that was Schrodinger's take on it. But the fact that so many people took it seriously makes quantum mechanics seem extremely unbelievable. Whenever I make a quantum video, I inevitably get comments outright rejecting it. People claiming that physicists have somehow lost touch with reality. That they're spending too much time in a lab and need to go outside and touch some grass or something. That's not how it is, though. Quantum mechanics works. It's one of the most well-tested models we have. And there is a solution to the Schrodinger's cat problem. Several, in fact. You just need to understand some important fundamentals of quantum mechanics. One, it's not really about size or scale. It's about isolation. Larger systems are just more difficult to isolate. Subatomic particles like electrons display quantum behavior all the time. Does an entire atom? Yes, but less often. We've seen quantum behavior in entire molecules under the right conditions. So clearly there isn't a hard boundary with size, but it does seem to get harder and harder to see quantum effects the larger we go. Which brings us to the isolation idea. In the Schrodinger's cat scenario, this box is assumed to be perfectly sealed. It's completely isolated from its surroundings, which seems pretty unrealistic for a box. Even if the box were air-sealed and completely sound-absorbent, the cat is still releasing heat, which would warm the box. But you know what? Let's give this thing the benefit of the doubt and say it's perfectly sealed. It's still not a quantum system. The cat is made of billions of billions of billions of atoms, most of which are not isolated from each other in the right way, let alone the immediate surroundings inside the box. The cat is not a quantum object. It is either awake or asleep. No superposition. The same argument goes for the sleeping gas. It's either released or it isn't, not both. But this begs the question, how can that be true if it's activated by a decaying atom? Well, the atom is also not quantum. Two, an observation does not require a person or even a conscious mind. It's a terrible word choice. There's this misconception that quantum entities are particles when they're being watched and waves when they're not. The so-called wave-particle duality. It's a gross misrepresentation of what's happening. Though it has given us some pretty funny memes. This is not about people watching particles. You're not changing reality by looking at it. Quantum physics is not magic. It's just statistics. I'll admit though, statistics does kind of feel like magic sometimes, but I digress. The decay of a large atom is completely random. The decay of a large collection of those atoms is predictable, statistically speaking. None of those atoms decayed because we looked at them though. We only know about it because we looked. The atom would have decayed whether we looked at it or not for one very important reason. Atomic decay emits stuff. The moment that emitted particle interacts with anything in the surrounding environment, the quantum shenanigans are over. Could that be with a detector a human has access to? Sure. But the detector inside Schrodinger's box is not accessible to anyone outside the box. Still counts as an observation. It doesn't even have to be a detector. It counts if those emitted particles hit air molecules or the walls of the box. It all counts as observation. All that matters is whether or not information about that quantum system is available. If it is, it's not a quantum system anymore. And I mean literally just available. Whether or not a conscious mind ever learns that information is completely irrelevant. And frankly, a physical model that only applies when people are around would be pretty useless. 3. Quantum effects are beyond the human experience, so your intuitions no longer apply. I am by no means trying to argue that quantum mechanics isn't weird. It's weird AF. But there's this prevailing idea that somehow human brains are incapable of understanding it. Richard Feynman once said this on camera, and a lot of other physicists have said similar things. I don't buy it, though. I bet there's a lot of physicists who understand quantum mechanics quite well. Understanding it is not the problem. Explaining it is. A lot of teaching is about meeting your students where they are. But like I said, quantum mechanics is beyond the human experience. There's no way to relate it to human life, so there's no way to meet students where they are. The explain it like I'm five thing doesn't work here. But just because something can't be explained to you, that doesn't mean you can't understand it. It just requires a lot of experience. You need to spend years with it before you understand it. You need to work with the math first, which is why a common motto in quantum mechanics is shut up and calculate. Also, intuition is never the primary goal of science. It's to have an explanation that matches reality. Usefulness is the goal. Any intuition we gain is just a bonus. And until next time, remember, it's okay to be a little crazy. Gaius suggested that we rename the speed of light to the speed of causality. Technically, it's the maximum speed of causality. Cause and effect can occur at any speed lower than that. But honestly, we've been calling this thing the speed of light for hundreds of years. Good luck getting anyone to change now. And thanks for watching.